My name is Walid Shuibat. I was born as a Muslim who desired the destruction of God's people. In trying to disprove the God of the Bible, I actually found him. Now I have dedicated my life to revealing the truth about Islam through books, radio, television, and the internet. In this series, we will discuss biblical end times prophecy and what the God of the Bible has to say about the very days we are living in now.
We meet at a time of great tension between the United States and Muslims around the world. The relationship between Islam and the West includes centuries of coexistence and cooperation, but also conflict and religious wars. I've come here to Cairo to seek a new beginning. The United States will never be at war with Islam.
Name me one that is not Muslim. In every single context where Christ is on earth fighting, he's fighting a Muslim country.
Does the Bible predict such a cataclysmic event with so many Muslim nations? The answer is absolutely yes. My turning point from being a Muslim terrorist began the day I spent the best $10 of my life to purchase a Bible. Perhaps the most crucial discovery I made was that the Bible is not simply a book filled with wise sayings and deep thoughts for personal meditation, as is commonly thought. The Bible is many things, including a roadmap of destiny with many details concerning the future of humanity. For me, it was exciting to also realize that much of its focus is on the Middle East, where I was born and grew up. On a personal level, the Bible was also a mirror that showed me everything that was wrong in my own soul. You can only imagine what it did to this pride-filled Muslim when I studied detailed scenarios of the future rise and fall of Islamic nations and coalitions. I have taken courses during my college days in Psychology 101, English 101, and Sociology 101, but I never imagined taking a course on Futurology 101. Here I am not only talking about the predictive elements of the Bible. Pride is a disease worse than anything else that we could ever deal with. The effects that Hitler and Nazism had on the German people were far worse than the effects that the drug epidemic is having on modern-day America. Today, we see the rise of a similar pride epidemic that is growing on an international level in 50-some Muslim states across the globe. As a result, we could very shortly be dealing with several Islamo-Nazi wars on numerous fronts around the world. Does the Bible predict such a cataclysmic event with so many Muslim nations? The answer is absolutely yes. You can't imagine how I felt when I read the Bible and found so much that describes the Mahdi who I had learned so much about growing up. The shock to me was that while a character identical to my Mahdi was seen throughout the pages of the Bible, this character was not called the Mahdi, but rather the Antichrist. Were the prophets of the Bible Islamophobes? After all, the Mahdi to us Sunni Muslims was the rightly guided and awaited one. The Shia Muslims refer to him as Sahib al-Zaman, the Lord of the Age. This is exactly what the Bible calls Satan, the Lord of the Age, in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. You might think that this is simply a coincidence. Once I am done demonstrating the dozens of similarities between Islam's system and that of the Antichrist, you will not be able to claim mere coincidence. But what should really frighten everyone is that this Antichrist story is not simply a nightmare story that one reads about in some ancient sacred texts. but it is rapidly becoming a reality right before our eyes. According to Islamic tradition, the Mahdi doesn't merely emerge as some vague great religious leader. He will return to reinstate the office of the caliphate. Islam directs its followers, quote, "If you see him, go and give him your allegiance, even if you have to crawl over ice, because he is the vice regent, the Khalifa of Allah, the Mahdi. For he will pave the way for and establish the government of the family or community of Muhammad. Every believer will be obligated to support him." Briefly, the hadith or sunnah are the records of both the words and the deeds of the Prophet Muhammad. In other words, the Quran is "Thus says Allah," and the hadith is "Thus says Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam." The hadiths are crucial to understand when one debates with Muslim apologists. Whenever a non-Muslim brings up the issue of Islamic terrorism, the standard Muslim apologist will almost inevitably say something like, "Show me a single verse in the Quran that teaches violence." This has been a common technique to throw off Westerners, because whatever verse is given, it will then be explained away as speaking of self-defense or as commandments that were only given on one particular occasion. In other words, all of the commandments in the Quran which call Muslims to jihad are obsolete and not applicable today. But this is sheer trickery, public image jihad kind of thing. The first response to such a question should always be this question: do you consider Muhammad to be the best authority to interpret the Quran? In other words, is the hadith authoritative to the Muslim? This results in a Jesus-style checkmate, because if a Muslim denies the authority of the hadith, then he is denying Muhammad's authority as prophet. Most often, the wiggly Muslim apologist will claim that he does not believe in many of the hadith, particularly the ones that you cite in the course of the discussion about violence. But this argument will always end when a powerful Quranic verse is given that states, "All you believe, obey Allah and obey his messenger and those in authority among you." If you fall into dispute about a matter, refer it back to Allah and his messenger if you believe in Allah and the last days. This is in Quran, Surah chapter 4, verse 59. After this, in accordance to this commandment from Allah, any Muslim who denies the hadith is not only denying Allah's commandment, but Allah himself. This is comparable to a Christian denying the New Testament. In reality, most wiggly Muslim apologists do not deny the hadith at all. They simply deny it in front of you. Few Westerners realize that Muslims are allowed to conceal the truth regarding this issue when speaking to non-Muslims. The Sunnah or the Hadith is as important to a Muslim as the New Testament is to a Christian. This Sunnah is everything besides the Quran that came from God's messenger. It explains and provides details of the laws found in the Quran. This is in the Hadith itself. There are no serious scholars today who would deny the 200 or so commandments found in the hadith, which promote nothing short of jihad by the sword, including unprovoked invasions for the sole purpose of advancing the worship of Allah. Always keep in mind the difference between Islam and Christianity can be summed up in one statement: Christianity is Calvary, Islam is cavalry. The goal of Muhammad, the Khilafa, the Mahdi, and all obedient Muslims is to achieve one goal and one goal alone: to advance the only glory of Allah as the supreme God by jihad, invitation first, then war, until there are none left who will not say, there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger. The special title of Messiah, although retained in the Islamic tradition, actually is void of any truly biblical messianic qualities. According to Islam, Jesus will not restore the nation of Israel to the Jewish people, nor will Jesus' purpose be to save and deliver his faithful followers from the ongoing persecution of the Antichrist. In Islam, Jesus comes back as a radical Muslim to lead the Muslim armies to abolish Christianity and to slaughter the Jews and to break the cross. As ironic and as perverted as that may sound, that is exactly what fundamental Muslims throughout the world believe and are waiting for.
We will return to Waleed Shubat in a moment.
The man sitting next to me can certainly tell us he was a terrorist.
A former PLO terrorist.
Former terrorist now living in the US.
A former Muslim terrorist.
And raised a Muslim.
Fighting for the justice of Israel.
We have to stand with Israel. Judea is the heart of the Jewish people.
Waleed Shubat.
Waleed Shubat.
Waleed Shubat.
One word caused me to believe in the truth of the Bible, and that's the word Israel.
The problem is a massive racist ideology that is growing throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world.
On this program, we are offering for your tax-deductible gift of $55 the DVD lecture series Islam, Prophecy in the Bible, which includes the free DVD of the miraculous testimonies of the three ex-terrorists and how three men went from being Islamic terrorists to now ambassadors for Christ. Please call now at 1-877-832-7200 or send your gift to Forum for Middle East Understanding at 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940. This is the first TV series produced by the Waleed Shubat Foundation, with the support of many friends, has enabled us to produce this landmark TV series, which brings clarity to the scriptures concerning the end times. Waleed Shubat, for 17 years, ever since converting to Christianity, after his wife challenged him to show her all the corruptions in the Bible, when he was trying to convert her to Islam. Since 2003, Waleed has been speaking out on television, radio, and the internet concerning the threat of Islam reaching millions with the truth. We will now return to Waleed Shubat on End Times Today.
All in all, we have clearly seen that Islam is an Antichrist religion. But is there evidence that Islam is the Antichrist religion? Now we will examine hard-hitting DNA conclusive arguments to support our theory. When comparing Old Testament heroes with Messiah, it is common to focus on Joseph, the suffering Messiah, and David as the king Messiah. Joseph's rejection by his brothers signifies Israel's rejection of Christ. David is a type of king Messiah because Christ's kingdom will be established in Jerusalem. But the one character in the Bible that is virtually never focused upon when searching for types of Christ is Gideon, the warrior Messiah. Gideon is crucial if we want to understand what the Messiah will do during his war expeditions after he sets foot on the Mount of Olives to fight for the Battle of Jerusalem. Though it is rarely discussed, Christ, like Gideon, will fight against Midian. The Bible refers to Midian as Ishmaelites in Judges chapter 8, verse 22. They are the descendants of Abraham's fourth son with his concubine Keturah. Like Gideon, the Bible portrays Christ as fighting against the inhabitants of Arabia. God came from Teman, the Holy One from Mount Paran. His glory covered the heavens and his praise filled the earth. His splendor was like the sunrise, rays flashed from his hand where his power was hidden. Habakkuk 3:3-4. Jesus in person returning from battle out of Teman in Arabia. How often is this discussed in churches? When was the last time we had a Sunday school? Today we will be discussing how Christ will come fighting out of Arabia. It never happens. How often is this discussed in churches? It needs to be. Jesus will physically return and will judge not only the inhabitants of Arabia, but also Kush, which includes the modern-day Islamic nations of Sudan and Somalia. I saw the tents of Kushan in distress, the dwellings of Midian in anguish. Habakkuk 3:5-6. Midian refers to the regions east of the Jordan River and southwards on into modern Saudi Arabia. This is the heart of the Islamic territory. Portrayals of battles like this, with Christ fighting against Muslim nations, are actually found throughout the Old Testament. The enemies that come against Christ are described as this: they come for violence, their faces are set like the east wind, they gather captives like sand, they scoff at kings, and princes are scorned by them. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 9 to 10. The enemies like the east wind are the locusts of Arabia and the kings of the east. And in case someone thinks that this is simply one minor war expedition by Messiah against Muslims, but that the real showdown is with European Antichrist, as many think, consider the context of Habakkuk. It is the final battle of Messiah against the Antichrist, who is described as the most proud in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, who breaks the peace treaty and proclaims war in the name of his God. Then his mind changes and he transgresses. He commits offense, ascribing his power to his God. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 11. The book of Numbers, in one of the earliest, clearest, and most direct messianic prophecies in the Bible, also speaks about the coming of the Messiah to specifically destroy and conquer these same peoples. This prophecy was made by Balaam and was given to Balak, the king of the Midianites. A star will come out of Jacob, a scepter will rise out of Israel. He will crush the forehead of Moab, the skulls of all the sons of Seth. Edom will be conquered, Seir, his enemy, will be conquered, but Israel will grow strong. A ruler will come out of Jacob and destroy the survivors of the city. Numbers 24:17-19. The Messiah is portrayed as descending from Jacob and possessing the scepter, a clear reference to his future rule over Israel. These three names, Moab, Edom, and Seir, are all referring to the same general people and the same general region. It is the peoples who lived to the east and southeast of Israel. Is Europe located immediately to the southeast of Israel? Or is this the location of Arabia? Ezekiel 35 speaks of judgment of Mount Seir in verse 1 and connects it with Edom. As you rejoiced because the inheritance of the house of Israel was desolate, so I will do to you. You shall be desolate, O Mount Seir, as well as all Edom, all of it. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. Greater Edom, encompassing the land from Teman to Dedan, which is today from Yemen to Saudi Arabia. When Jesus returns to take hold of his scepter and destroy his enemies, who are they? They are all the Arab peoples from the east of Israel. In Isaiah, the theme is repeated: the Lord will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove the disgrace of his people from all the earth. Jehovah has spoken. Isaiah 25, verse 8. Has this happened yet, or is this referring to the period after Christ has returned? Unless death has already been swallowed up and I have missed it, this is clearly about the return of Christ. The hand of Jehovah will rest on this mountain. But Moab will be trampled under him as straw is trampled down in the manure. Isaiah 25, verse 10. God doesn't seem too worried about using polite or politically correct language here. Once again, the Messiah comes back to trample Moab. He is pictured as standing with his hand of blessing resting on Israel, while his foot is pressing against the neck of Moab. For those who hold to the European Antichrist paradigm, why does God specifically mention Moab and not any nations from Europe? If you take a face value approach to interpretation, which is more reasonable to conclude that this passage is pointing to the final end time defeat of the modern day physical and spiritual descendants of Moab, or that this passage is allegorically pointing us to Europe? Let's get real here. The Bible simply does not teach a European Antichrist. The prophecy of Isaiah 63 concludes with the Messiah emerging out of Edom with his robes literally drenched with blood from the multitudes of those that he has slaughtered. That's right. Have you ever seen Messiah portrayed this way? He left as a lamb, but he returns as a mighty conquering lion. Who is this coming from Edom, from Bozra, with his garment stained crimson? Who is this, robed in splendor, striding forward in the greatness of his strength? It is I speaking in righteousness, mighty to save. Why are your garments red like those of one treading the winepress? I have trodden the winepress alone. From the nations no one was with me. I trampled them in my anger and trod them down in my wrath. Their blood spattered my garments, and I stained all my clothing. For the day of vengeance was in my heart, and the year of my redemption has come. Isaiah 63:1-4. Messiah will even personally judge Lebanon. In Isaiah 10:34, an amazing declaration is made that Lebanon will fall by the Mighty One. This is the Messiah who will judge the anti-Israel elements within Lebanon, and all of Lebanon will bow before him. I can see some argue that the Mighty One here is God the Father in heaven and is not the Messiah on earth. Yet Isaiah 19:20 leaves no question. He will send them a Savior and a Mighty One, and he will deliver them. Who is this Savior? How is he sent? In the Psalms, Messiah is portrayed as the soldier and a fighter with the same reference, Mighty One. Gird your sword upon your thigh, O Mighty One, with your glory and your majesty. Psalm 45, verse 3. In Zephaniah 3, this Mighty One is in physically present in Israel's midst. The Lord your God in your midst, the Mighty One will save. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. It is clear that this is the Messiah. God the Father is utterly transcendent. He is not physically present in Israel. This prophecy regarding Lebanon is also the judgment against the Antichrist. O my people who dwell in Zion, do not be afraid of the Assyrian. He shall strike you with a rod and lift up his staff against you in the manner of Egypt. Isaiah 10:24-25. Antichrist will be responsible for the destruction of Lebanon. For the violence done to Lebanon will cover you, and the plunder of the beasts which made them afraid because of men's blood, and the violence of the land and the city, and of all who dwell in it. Habakkuk 2:17. So why did the West miss this? It is common in the West when someone initiates a prophecy discussion, that the discussion is immediately turned to the Book of Revelation. Even on the most prophecy documentaries, they begin and revolve around allegorical passages from the Book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. Why not start from the beginning of the book? Why not start with the many literal references in the Bible regarding prophecy? Instead of jumping right into an examination of the various allegorical visions and dreams about beasts, horns, dragons, and so forth, why not start with what is clear and straightforward? This would be a much more reasonable approach, would it not? When attempting to form a solid biblical basis for understanding the Antichrist system, one needs to rely on the full counsel of Scripture, not merely the last and most mysterious book of the Bible, that is the Book of Revelation. While the prophetic snapshots found in Revelation or the Book of Daniel are very important, they are only a small part of the much larger pool of information that the Bible has given us. Too many interpreters begin with these few snapshots, and when their conclusions are not supported by the wealth of other prophetic passages, they usually either massage those passages to conform to their established presumptions, or they just ignore them altogether. But we cannot take such a pick-and-choose approach. Again, in order to form an accurate and truly biblical perspective on the end times, we must rely on the complete and full counsel of Scripture. In order for any theory or position to be convincing and more universally received by the church, it is necessary that all of the passages be sufficiently reconciled. They must all come together cohesively in order to paint one consistent picture. Now that we have laid the main foundation for the series, we will discuss specifics to link Islam as the Antichrist religion and the Islamic Mahdi as the Antichrist himself. We will start with comparisons of the Mahdi and the Antichrist. Then we will talk about specific actions the Antichrist takes that the Bible specifically warns us about. Finally, we will discuss the end goal of the Antichrist and how God has given us instructions for today's world and the coming days ahead.
Walid Shubat, a former Muslim and, like Paul of the Bible, a former terrorist, now a watchman on the wall, is bringing the truth and warning on the issues of Islamic fundamentalism through television, radio, as well as the internet. Please help us by partnering with us today by calling 1-877-832-7200 or sending your tax-deductible donation to Forum for Middle East Understanding, 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940.
My name is Walid Shuibat. I was born as a Muslim who desired the destruction of God's people. In trying to disprove the God of the Bible, I actually found him. Now I have dedicated my life to revealing the truth about Islam through books, radio, television, and the internet. In this series, we will discuss biblical end times prophecy and what the God of the Bible has to say about the very days we are living in now.
We meet at a time of great tension between the United States and Muslims around the world. The relationship between Islam and the West includes centuries of coexistence and cooperation, but also conflict and religious wars. I've come here to Cairo to seek a new beginning. The United States will never be at war with Islam.
Name me one that is not Muslim. In every single context where Christ is on earth fighting, he's fighting a Muslim country.
Does the Bible predict such a cataclysmic event with so many Muslim nations? The answer is absolutely yes. Speaking to a Western audience of several prominent prophecy authors in Dallas, Texas, I asked a Jesus-style question. Besides the argument over whether Magog is Russia, can you cite any literal references to a nation that God destroys in the end times that is not Muslim? I waited and waited. No one responded. I then asked, why are you not raising your hands? Is it because you cannot find any? Or is it because you have written all these books which you cannot recant? I have asked the same question to thousands in churches throughout the US, Canada, and England. Yet to this day, no one has disagreed with me that there are no literal references to non-Muslim nations that God destroys in end times anywhere in the Bible. We now need to address the important misconceptions regarding the scope and geographical focus of biblical prophecy. For many years, it has been taught that in the last days, literally every nation of the earth will be utterly dominated by the Antichrist, that there will be no place to escape from the dreaded mark of the beast, that every last nation on the world will come against Jerusalem. Zechariah 12 is used to validate the theory. All the nations of the earth will be gathered together to attack Jerusalem. Later in Zechariah 14, we read that God will gather all the nations to Jerusalem to fight against it. The prophet Joel prophesies similarly, I will gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. The apostle John, using perhaps the strongest language of all, goes so far as to say that the Antichrist will be given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. This would seem as an ironclad case for the Antichrist ruling the entire world, which he uses in the march against Jerusalem. However, the word used for earth in Zechariah is Eretz, which most often is translated as land. But there are many verses in the Bible that also use this same type of language, yet are all clearly not speaking of the whole globe per se. This type of language is actually found quite frequently in the Bible. For instance, Daniel the prophet, speaking of King Nebuchadnezzar, O King the Most High, God gave your father, Nebuchadnezzar, sovereignty and greatness and glory and splendor. Because of the high position, he gave him all the peoples and nations and men, every language, dreaded and feared him. Did every single nation in the earth fear Nebuchadnezzar's father? Or did only those nations that had heard of Nebuchadnezzar's father dread him? Was Daniel speaking of every nation of the whole earth? Or only those nations that were in close enough proximity to Babylon to be affected by her? Were the native peoples of Hawaii or Denmark living in dread of Nebuchadnezzar's father? Of course not. Daniel's use of the phrase all the peoples and nations and men of every language was more of an emphatic expression used to convey his point. There are numerous examples like this through the whole Bible. Let's return to the passage in Zechariah 12 and read it in full context. I am going to make Jerusalem a cup that sends all the surrounding peoples reeling. Judah will be besieged as well as Jerusalem. on that day when all the nations of the earth are gathered against her, I will make Jerusalem an immovable rock for all the nations. All who try to remove it will injure themselves. Who does this passage specifically say will attack Jerusalem? The answer is the surrounding peoples. Today, the nations that encircle Israel on every side are Muslim. The prophet Joel confirms this as well. Speaking of the final attack against Jerusalem, Joel prophesied, I will gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. Then I will enter into judgment with them there on behalf of my people, my inheritance Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations, and they have divided my land. Hasten and come, all you surrounding nations, for there I will sit and judge all these surrounding nations. Ezekiel, for instance, also specifies who the nations are that will attack Israel and incur God's judgment at the end of the age. O mountains of Israel, this is what Jehovah the Sovereign says to the mountains and hills, to the ravines and valleys, to the desolate ruins and the deserted towns that have been plundered and ridiculed by the rest of the nations around you. This is what Jehovah the Sovereign says. In my burning zeal, I have spoken against the rest of the nations, against all Edom, for with glee and with malice in their hearts, they made my land their own possession, so that they might plunder its pasture land. Then the nations that are left round about you will know that I, Jehovah, have rebuilt the ruined places and planted that which was desolate. I, Jehovah, have spoken and will do it. Notice the pattern. First, there is specific mention of the nations around you. Then one of them is named Edom, while Edom is used as a general term referring to the enemies of the Jews who lived to the east of Israel. Today, this would most specifically be Jordan and Saudi Arabia. The Bible makes every effort to clarify the nations round about. Another reason the position that every nation will fall to Antichrist is impossible is the fact that some will resist the Antichrist and even attack him. Many countries will fall, but Edom, Moab, and the leaders of Ammon will be delivered from his hand. The Bible says many countries, not all. Elsewhere we read that Kittim will come against him. Daniel 11:30 says that ships of Kittim, often translated as out of the west, will come against the king of the north, the Antichrist. For the ships of Kittim shall come against him. Josephus identifies Kittim as Cyprus. The name was first used to identify the Phoenician port of Kittium in Cyprus. In fact, Kittim actually appears in the Dead Sea Scrolls and is even translated as Romans in the Septuagint. In general, the term Kittim was used to refer to all the islands and settlements along the sea coasts, as well as to the people who succeeded them when the Phoenician power decayed. Thus, Kittim generally refers to the islands and coasts of the Mediterranean and the races that inhabit those areas. Note that none of these lands are Muslim. If the Antichrist were to come from the Western Roman Empire or Europe, the ships of Kittim would not come against him. To answer the question, are any European nations mentioned in the Bible? Well, yes. The ships of Kittim in the Septuagint are literally the European nations from Cyprus to Italy, even to Spain. According to the prophecy of Daniel 11, they attacked Antiochus, who was a foreshadow of the Antichrist, As such, this passage could very well involve a dual fulfillment, and we could have a prophecy about a European attack against the forces of the Antichrist. Consider Turkey's army. It supersedes the combined forces of Great Britain, Italy, and France combined. Yet Turkey is no match for Rome's fleet. Our fleet cannot perhaps compare with the fleet of Italy, but our army is mighty, explains Ziya Basha, Turkey's ambassador to the United States. Turkey's army is stronger, but Italy's fleet can defeat Turkey. No European country is featured in end times prophecy as receiving a judgment of wrath. Rome, for example, is mentioned several times and Spain twice, without a single reference to judgments. Ezekiel 28 also confirms that the most powerful nations on earth will attack the Antichrist. Behold, therefore I will bring strangers upon thee, the terrible of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of thy wisdom, and they shall defile thy brightness. The term terrible implies not ugly or awful, but very powerful in battle, that is, terrible in battle. God will rise up several nations to attack the Antichrist. Therefore, it cannot be true that every nation of the earth will fall to the Antichrist and attack Israel. There have always been attempts to establish a one-world government, yet they have never succeeded. Why? Because God already in Genesis established that the nations will always be divided, and the devil can never combine the entire earth and the entire globe under his command, because God ordained it as such. Far too many in the West fail to remember the actual context of the Bible. Too many Westerners read the Bible narcissistically. Many books have been written that revolve around the West and interpret history through a Western-centric lens. When I opened the Bible for the first time, I read about the places where I grew up. I read about Bethlehem and Jericho. Far too many Westerners have missed the obvious fact that the Bible is thoroughly Middle Eastern. In the biblical worldview, Jerusalem is the center of the earth, not Europe or America. The biblical prophecies about the end times are no different.
We will return to Walid Shubat in a moment.
The man sitting next to me can certainly tell us he was a terrorist.
A former PLO terrorist.
Former terrorist now living in the US.
A former Muslim terrorist.
And raised a Muslim.
Fighting for the justice of Israel.
We have to stand with Israel. Judea is the heart of the Jewish people.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
One word caused me to believe in the truth of the Bible, and that's the word Israel.
The problem is a massive racist ideology that is growing throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world.
On this program, we are offering for your tax-deductible gift of $55 the DVD lecture series Islam Prophecy in the Bible, which includes the free DVD of the miraculous testimonies of the three ex-terrorists and how three men went from being Islamic terrorists to now ambassadors for Christ. Please call now at 1-877-832-7200 or send your gift to Forum for Middle East Understanding at 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940. This is the first TV series produced by the Walid Shubat Foundation, with the support of many friends, has enabled us to produce this landmark TV series, which brings clarity to the scriptures concerning the end times. Walid Shubat, for 17 years, ever since converting to Christianity, after his wife challenged him to show her all the corruptions in the Bible, when he was trying to convert her to Islam. Since 2003, Walid has been speaking out on television, radio, and the internet concerning the threat of Islam, reaching millions with the truth. We will now return to Walid Shubat on End Times Today.
Throughout the Bible, the attributes of the Antichrist are always described as being entirely opposite of the characteristics of Christ. While Jesus is called the truth, The Antichrist is called the father of lies, John 8:44. Christ is called the Holy One. The Antichrist is called the lawless one, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8. Christ is the Son of God, while the Antichrist is the son of perdition, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. Christ is called the mystery of godliness. The Antichrist, he is the mystery of iniquity, Revelation 17:5. He will not have the same names as Christ, yet he will claim just enough Messiah-like attributes to form an effective camouflage to deceive the nations of the earth. As we examine the attributes of Allah and his Messiah figure, the Mahdi in this case, we will see that they perfectly match what the Bible has warned us of. Doctrinally, Islam and the Antichrist spirit are in perfect agreement because both deny the Trinity and the divine sonship of Christ. As the Bible describes, probably one of the most important verses in the Bible regarding Antichrist and the spirit of Antichrist. The Bible says, "Who is the liar? It is the man who denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a man is the Antichrist. He denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever acknowledges the Son has the Father also." This is 1 John 2:22 to 23. So whoever denies the reality of the Trinity and the fact that Jesus is the Son of God embodies the spirit of the Antichrist, period. Knowing this, Antichrist will never say that I am the Son of God. Instead, he will mock such a notion. This is crucial. The religion of Islam has as one of its most core and foundational beliefs a blatant denial of Christ as God's Son. This denial is found several times throughout the Quran. According to the Quran, whoever believes that Jesus is the Son of God commits a terrible blasphemy and is cursed by Allah. But beyond the fact that the Quran clearly teaches Antichrist doctrines, Islam has also created a perverted Jesus that is an affront to the historical Jesus of the Christian faith. Growing up, I was always taught that when Jesus returns, he will declare himself to be a Muslim. He will deny all the claims of being God or the Son of God and lead many Christians to convert to Islam. Regarding those who do not convert to Islam, the Quran states that Jesus will be a witness against them on the day of judgment. I quote, "There is not one of the people of the scriptures, that is Christians and Jews, but will believe in him before his death, and on the day of resurrection, he will be a witness against them." Quran 4, 159. Muslim scholars explain that the phrase "will believe in him before his death" means that Christians and Jews will confirm that he is alive and has not died, and he is not God or the Son of God, but merely Allah's slave and messenger. And Isa, Jesus in this case, will testify against those who had called him the Son of God. The so-called moderates, Sheikh Qabbani, agrees. Like all Prophet Jesus, he says, came with the divine message of surrender to God Almighty, which is Islam. This verse shows that when Jesus returns, he will personally correct the misrepresentation and misinterpretation about himself. He will affirm the true message that he brought in his time as a prophet, and that he never claimed to be the Son of God. Furthermore, he will reaffirm in his second coming what he prophesied in his first coming, bearing witness to the seal of the messenger, Prophet Muhammad. Ayatollah Bakr al-Sadr and Ayatollah Murtada Mutahharri, authors of The Awaited Savior, concur. I quote, "Jesus will descend from heaven and espouse the cause of the Mahdi. The Christians and the Jews will see him and recognize his true status. The Christians will abandon their faith in his godness." Once again, the canonized doctrines of Islam perfectly fulfill what the Apostle John defined as the spirit of Antichrist. The Bible warned Christians long ago to test the spirits to see whether or not they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this, you know the spirit of God. Every spirit that confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. 1 John 4:3. The litmus test to know whether or not a spirit is from God or from the devil is specifically whether or not it acknowledges that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has become a man. Any spirit that does not acknowledge this is from Satan and is the spirit of the Antichrist. The Apostle John also adds, this is how you can recognize the spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is from God, this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and even now is already in the world. Many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the Antichrist. 2 John 1:7. That the Antichrist is a spirit that is identified as a liar and a deceiver, which specifically denies that Jesus is the Savior of Israel, Jesus is the Savior of the world, the Trinity, or that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is God who came in the flesh. Both Muhammad and his Mahdi perfectly embody this Antichrist spirit. Muhammad denied both the Father and the Son. The Mahdi will come in Muhammad's spirit and will do the same. What is most holy to Christians is considered blasphemous in Islam, and what is holy in Islam is blasphemous to Christians. An understanding of Islam's reversalist or contrarian ideology is crucial for everyone who wants to understand Satan's attempt to contradict and undermine the basic teachings of the Bible. Islam makes it one of its highest priorities to deny all of the essential doctrines of Christianity, especially his relationship with the Father. Just ask any Muslim, what are your main objections to Christians? And their immediate response will be, Jesus is not the Son of God. Neither is he God. Neither is God our Father. Neither did he die on the cross. Try it. My Catholic mother-in-law asked me prior to marrying her daughter, do you believe in Jesus? Being a Muslim, I responded, of course. Then you can marry my daughter. However, had she asked me, do you believe he is the Son of God? I would have said, absolutely not. The trick that Muslims use, however, is that Islam teaches that Jesus is indeed the Messiah. After all, the Quran calls him Al-Masih, the Messiah. While it is true that Islam does retain the title of Messiah for Jesus, when one asks a Muslim to define what the title actually means in Islam, the definitions given are always hollow and fall entirely short of containing any true messianic substance. In Islam, Jesus is merely another prophet in a very long line of prophets. Biblically speaking, however, the role of the Messiah, among other things, also entails being a divine priestly savior, a deliverer, and the king of the Jews. As you shall see, rather than being a Messiah who saves or delivers Israel and all of the faithful followers in any way, in the Islamic traditions, Jesus instead returns to lead Israel's enemies against her in battle and to kill or convert all Jews and Christians to Islam. This would be the equivalent of calling Adolf Hitler rather than Jesus as Israel's deliverer. For now, we see that the Apostle John informs us that just before the final hour, a very specific spirit will dominate the earth. This spirit will deny many of the essential biblical doctrines regarding who Jesus is and what he came to do. Islam could not epitomize the spirit any more perfectly. This spirit was already in the world, 1 John 4:3, even in John's time. Several cults exist in John's day and continued with such a spirit. Islam stemmed from these Christian heretical groups such as the Gnostics and the Nestorians. While John's warning in the first century was speaking primarily to the heretical Gnostic Christians, when Islam came along, it literally adopted nearly every early Christian heresy and absorbed them all in one new heretical potpourri that we call Islam. As such, John's warning against the spirit of the Antichrist was virtually consummated in the religion of Muhammad, the greatest heresiarch that the world has ever known. Thank you for watching End Times Today. For more information, please visit us at www.shoebat.com. SHOEBAT.com. Thank you.
Waleed Shoebat, a former Muslim and, like Paul of the Bible, a former terrorist, now a watchman on the wall, is bringing the truth and warning on the issues of Islamic fundamentalism through television, radio, as well as the internet. Please help us by partnering with us today by calling 1-877-832-7200 or sending your tax-deductible donation to Forum for Middle East Understanding, 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940.
My name is Waleed Shoebat. I was born as a Muslim who desired the destruction of God's people. In trying to disprove the God of the Bible, I actually found him. Now I have dedicated my life to revealing the truth about Islam through books, radio, television, and the internet. In this series, we will discuss biblical end times prophecy and what the God of the Bible has to say about the very days we are living in now.
We meet at a time of great tension between the United States and Muslims around the world. The relationship between Islam and the West includes centuries of coexistence and cooperation, but also conflict and religious wars. I've come here to Cairo to seek a new beginning. The United States will never be at war with Islam.
Name me one that is not Muslim. In every single context where Christ is on earth fighting, he's fighting a Muslim country.
Does the Bible predict such a cataclysmic event with so many Muslim nations? The answer is absolutely yes. In Islam, the most essential belief is called Tawheed, which refers to the strictest form of Unitarian monotheism imaginable. This is the absolute oneness of God in Islam. In Islam, God is utterly alone, and because adherence to Tawheed is the highest and most important commandment in the religion, then the greatest sin is called Shirk, which is opposite of Tawheed. Shirk in Islam is idolatry, or associating partners with God. As one Muslim group in Toronto has stated in their publication, Invitation to Islam, murder, rape, child molestation, genocide. These are all some of the appalling crimes which occur in our world today. Many would think that these are the worst possible offenses which could be committed. But there is something which outweighs all these crimes put together. It is the crime of shirk. As the Quran said, surely they have disbelieved who say, Allah is the Messiah Jesus, son of Mary. But the Messiah said, O children of Israel, worship Allah exclusively. Quran 572. This verse is evidence that those who associate with Allah are kuffar and commit shirk, or the greatest shirk. If a person dies committing shirk and never repents of it, he will be permanent resident in hellfire. While the unpardonable sin in the Bible is to deny or blaspheme the Holy Spirit as God, in Islam, believing that God is the Holy Spirit is an unpardonable sin. Of course, that's in Matthew chapter 12, verse 31. The Holy Spirit, according to Islam, is the angel who spoke to Muhammad. Yet the being that spoke to Muhammad bears far more resemblance to Lucifer that's in the Bible than to any heavenly angel. Imagine that believing in the divinity of Christ is considered by many Muslims to be a far worse sin than committing murder. Meanwhile, in the backwards world of Islam, the Muslims of Sudan are even now carrying out a literal genocide against the black Sudanese, while the rest of the Muslim world turns its collective head and looks the other way. But believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and you stir up a hornet's nest. Neither the demons nor the Muslims can tolerate the truth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and the Lord of all. This denial is found several times, that Islam denying the Son. This is throughout the Quran. In the Quran it says, "In blasphemy indeed are those that say that God is Christ, the Son of Mary." They said that Most Gracious had begotten a son. You have uttered a gross blasphemy. The heavens are about to shatter, the earth is about to tear asunder, and the mountains are about to crumble, because they claim that the Most Gracious has begotten a son. It is not befitting the Most Gracious that he should beget a son. Quran 19:88-92. Another verse in the Quran states, the Christians call Christ the Son of Allah. That is a saying from their mouth. In this they but imitate what the unbelievers of old used to say. Allah's curse be on them, how they are deluded away from the truth. Quran 9:30. The Quran literally pronounces a curse on those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. People who say such things utter gross blasphemies and are likened to unbelievers or kuffar infidels. In his Institutes of Religion, Protestant reformer John Calvin rightly stated that the Muslims, although they proclaim at the top of their lungs that the creator of heaven and earth is God, still, while repudiating Christ, they substitute an idol in the place of the true God. While Islam attempts to create an acceptable form of monotheistic worship, it not only leaves out the most essential aspects of the saving relationship with God, but it also confronts these things head on and calls them the highest forms of blasphemy. A quote from the Quran, "Far be it from God that he should have a son." These words encircle the inside of the Dome of the Rock. This is the very location where for centuries God's people, the Jews, worshipped in their temple awaiting their Messiah. This is also where Jesus, the Son of God, the Jewish Messiah, will someday rule over the earth. Islam has literally built a monument of unreserved defiance to this future reality. But what is the grievous penalty that shall befall those who believe such things? According to Islamic narrative, Jesus will return to kill these polytheists, or the Trinitarian Christians.
But it does not end here. The Quran does not stop at denying that Jesus is the Son of God or that God exists as a Trinity.
We will return to Walid Shubat in a moment.
The man sitting next to me can certainly tell us he was a terrorist.
A former PLO terrorist.
Former terrorist now living in the US.
A former Muslim terrorist.
And raised a Muslim.
Fighting for the justice of Israel.
We have to stand with Israel. Judea is the heart of the Jewish people.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
One word caused me to believe in the truth of the Bible, and that's the word Israel.
The problem is a massive racist ideology that is growing throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world.
On this program, we are offering for your gift of $45, God's War on Terror, the best-selling book based on the series End Times Today. Included in this offer is a free copy of Walid's new book, For God or for Tyranny, co-authored by his son, which outlines why, without God in government, there is no freedom. Please call now at 1-877-832-7200 or send your gift to Forum for Middle East Understanding at 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940. This is the first TV series produced by the Walid Shubat Foundation. With the support of many friends, has enabled us to produce this landmark TV series, which brings clarity to the scriptures concerning the end times. Walid Shubat, for 17 years, ever since converting to Christianity, after his wife challenged him to show her all the corruptions in the Bible, when he was trying to convert her to Islam. Since 2003, Walid has been speaking out on television, radio, and the internet concerning the threat of Islam, reaching millions with the truth. We will now return to Walid Shubat on End Times Today.
With tears in his eyes, the Apostle Paul warned the Thessalonians that, quote, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ, Philippians 3:18. The church father Polycarp of Smyrna is a disciple of the Apostle John, also linked a denial of the cross to the Antichrist spirit in no uncertain terms when he said that everyone who does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is an Antichrist, and whomever does not confess the testimony of the cross is of the devil. Such a one is the firstborn of Satan. It should not come as a surprise, then, that Islam also denies the most central event of all redemptive history, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. That they say, the Quran says, in boast we killed Christ, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah, but they killed him not, nor crucified him, but so it was made to appear to them, and those who differ therein are full of doubts with no certain knowledge, but only conjecture to follow, for as surety they killed him not. Nay, Allah raised him up unto himself, and Allah is exalted in power and wise. Quran 4, 157-8. Ironically, among Islamic scholars, there are actually numerous conflicting theories regarding exactly what happened to Jesus. As such, it is actually the Muslims who have only conjecture to follow. But despite their inability to arrive at any form of consensus regarding to what happened to Jesus, Muslims are very much in agreement on at least one issue. He never died on the cross. When anyone picks up a Bible, they are almost immediately confronted with the fact that Satan is the greatest deceiver in history. It was shortly after having eaten the forbidden fruit that Eve said, "The serpent, Satan, deceived me, and I ate." In the New Testament, John the Apostle reminds us that anyone who denies that Jesus has come in the flesh is a deceiver and the Antichrist. Paul the Apostle elaborates on the deceptive role of the Antichrist when he also warned that the coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. And as the Bible concludes, it encourages us all with the fact that in the end, the devil who deceived them will be thrown into the lake of burning sulfur.
Amazingly, all such unsavory descriptions of Satan are easily found scattered throughout the Quran. But I will start with the most damning reference. Allah's bargaining by calling himself Khayrul Makirin, which literally means the greatest of all deceivers. This is found in Quran 354. But what are the circumstances in the Quran in Surah 354 that are causing Allah to be deceptive? Interestingly, the deception is regarding the story of Jesus' crucifixion. In Surah 355 it states, when Allah said to Jesus, I shall cause you to die, then will raise you up to myself. Allah, in this story, supposedly deceived the people by not allowing Jesus to die on the cross and resurrecting him instead. As Christ was going about to do his Father's work, Satan was concocting schemes for his firstborn, Muhammad. All of the most revered interpreters of the Quran, Ibn Kathir, Al-Tabari, Al-Jalalayn, Al-Qurtubi, interpreted Quran 354 as referring to Allah deceiving people to believe that Jesus was crucified when he was not. Qurtubi observes that some scholars have considered the word the best of schemers to be the one of God's beautiful names. Thus, one would pray, O best of schemers, scheme for me. This is a common Islamic prayer. Qurtubi also reports that the Prophet used to pray, O God, scheme for me and do not scheme against me. How is it that in the Bible it is the devil and his vessel, the Antichrist, that are repeatedly referred to as schemers, liars, deceivers? But in the Quran, it is Allah who is the greatest of all deceivers, and that's supposedly good. Satan knows full well who he is, and as he was inspiring the Quran, he couldn't help but brag a little bit. The Arabic words makara means to deceive, scheme, hatch up, cook up, connive. The Arabic Bible in Genesis 3:1 uses the same word for Satan. In Ahl al-Quran, which is the International Quranic Center, Mr. Sharif Sadiq explains, the meaning of makara, to deceive, as attributed in the Quran, conniving, is a weapon, like any other weapon, could be used for good or for evil, like a knife or a gun. According to Sharif, there are two types of conniving, one which is forbidden and the other noble. Not only do Satan and Allah share the characteristic of being deceivers par excellence, they also both love to specifically target one group above any. In the Quran, Ahlul Kitab, or the people of the book, which is the followers of the Bible in this case, as the Quran calls them, the Bible warns that Jews and Christians are Satan's favorite target. Yet in the Quran, and all throughout this sacred text, they are targeted by Allah. Does not Jesus warn, for false Christs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and miracles to deceive even the elect, if that were possible? See, I have told you so ahead of time. So if anyone tells you there he is out in the desert, do not go out. Or here he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. As a Muslim, I understood that according to Islamic tradition, the Mahdi will find some supposedly lost portions of the Old and New Testaments and even the Ark of the Covenant. And through these finds, he will argue with the Jews and Christians and win some to Islam. Ka'b al-Ahbar, an early Muslim commentator, says, quote, he will be called Mahdi because he will guide to something hidden and will bring out the Torah and the Gospel from a town called Antioch. As-Suyuti, another Muslim scholar, said that the Messenger of Allah, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, said, he is called the Mahdi because he will guide the people to a mountain in Syria from which he will bring out the volumes of Torah to refute the Jews. at the hands of the Mahdi, the Ark of the Covenant will be brought forth from the Lake of Tiberias and taken and placed in Jerusalem. I had always asked myself why Muslims were so specifically focused on attacking the integrity of the Bible. And today, not only Muslims, but the whole world. Even at most of the bookstores I visit, so many of the popular books are those that attack the historical Jesus and the reliability of the Bible. Rarely does one find a book that attacks the historical Buddha or the Bhagavad Gita, the Book of Mormon, the Yazidi al-Jilwah, Black Book, or the Quran. Nobody attacks these. I always wondered why. Why should they? For these lack any history or substance that is worthy of attack. Only a few Christians who will probably be called bigots expose these books and show the lack of real evidence that they truly don't have. So who is standing alone? Who truly believes in the one God? And who is uniting behind so many other gods? The Quran also lacks any detail to derive much of the history it supposedly documents. Instead, it only borrows apocryphal verses and old folk tales. I also asked myself this question. If the Jews were not truly God's people, then why did so many satanic empires and groups throughout history repeatedly make attempts to destroy them? Muslims all over the world spend so much time repeating and hammering on the claim that Israel does not belong in the land, that the Bible's history is fabricated, or simply that the Jews are evil. Why is there so much focus on attacking and destroying the Jews? And why are Muslims and Satan on the same side in this regard? Why is it that one of Mahdi's goals is to win converts from among the Christians and Jews, primarily by casting doubts on the reliability of the Bible? Why doesn't the Mahdi focus on the Hindus or the Buddhists? I have but one challenge to false gods of all non-biblical faiths. Declare to us the things to come. That's in Isaiah 41:22. Read it. If I may give the full challenge. The Bible says, present your case, says the Lord. Bring forth your strong reasons. This is what the king of Jacob says. Let them bring forth and show us what will happen. Let them show the former things. Show us the history. What they were, that we may consider them and know the later end of them, or declare to us things to come. Aha! Show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know you are gods. Yes, do good or do evil, that we may be dismayed and see it together. Indeed, you are nothing, and your works are nothing. He who chooses you is an abomination. If a religion cannot predict the future, Isaiah chapter 41 says they are an abomination. Then the Lord continues, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declared before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Nowhere in any other text I've seen such a declaration except in the Bible. The Quran has none of these things. Archaeologists in the Middle East contribute to the publication called Biblical Archaeological Review that comes out monthly through its challenges of the Bible. You also find much evidence attesting to historic confirmation of Scripture. I ask, if the Quran was such a great works, have you ever heard of a Quranic Archaeological Review? It is only the Biblical Archaeological Review. Why would the Muslim authorities put such a tight lid on the volumes of the oldest Qurans found in Al-Masjid Al-Kabir in Yemen? If I wish to purchase a facsimile copy of the Codex Vaticanus, I may do so. Why are copies of the top copy Quranic manuscript, considered one of the oldest Quranic manuscripts, still sitting unexamined in the top copy museum in Turkey? What are they afraid of? Why can't the oldest Quranic manuscripts face the same kind of critical examination that the most ancient biblical manuscripts had to endure for centuries? I will tell you the reason. because numerous aberrations from the standard Quranic text are found in all of those older manuscripts. Such aberrations, though not surprisingly to textual historians, are troubling at odds with the Orthodox Muslim claims that the Quran has reached us today exactly as it came down. It has not a jot or a dot missing. That's the claim. Why would the Yemen, then, and the Turkish authorities close the door on the research? The Dead Sea Scrolls, for example, were found to validate the authenticity of the Bible. In the Quran, Islam challenges mankind, quote, bring your proof if you are truthful. Islam challenges the world to bring something like the Quran, because the Quran is such a miraculous book, as they claim. What about the future of mankind? Is that all we should be focused on? Can the Quran provide 1,362 verses of a prophetic nature? Yet a prophecy from the Bible is fulfilled and the world goes mad over it. How can anyone explain Israel's return? Quote, fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your descendants from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Isaiah 43, 5-6. It is this God that I serve, the one who, quote, says to Jerusalem, you shall be inhabited, to the cities of Judah, you shall be built. Isaiah 44, 26. God promised to restore Jerusalem and Israel, and he is doing it. Imam al-Ghazali, one of the most famous Muslim theologians of all time, encourages lying so long as any positive or beneficial goal may be achieved. I quote, speaking is a means to achieve objectives. If a praiseworthy aim is attainable through both telling the truth and lying, it is unlawful to accomplish it through lying because there is no need for it. When it is possible to achieve such an aim by lying, but not by telling the truth, it is permissible to lie if attaining the goal is permissible. Talk about situational ethics. Imagine one of the Ten Commandments stating, thou shalt not lie and thou shalt not tell the truth. But one should do whatever is best to achieve victory. Ghazali also instructs Muslims to lie in order to attain material prosperity. I quote, know this, that lying is not sin by itself, but if it brings harm to you, it could be ugly. However, you can lie if that will keep you from evil or if it will result in prosperity. Abdullah al-Arabi rightly comments regarding the danger of that practice of lying in Islam is for the West. The principle of sanctioning lying for the cause of for Islam bears grave implications in matters relating to the spread of the religion of Islam in the West. Muslim activists employ deceptive tactics in their attempts to polish Islam's image and make it more attractive to prospective converts. Even many so-called moderate Muslims, in order to protect the image of Islam, the religion of peace after 9/11, they began to lead a double life. One side expressed aggression to the West in private meetings, and the other side expressed tolerance and peace in front of Western audiences. Take, for example, Siraj Wahaj, the first Muslim to deliver the daily prayer and speeches for love, brotherhood, and harmony before the U.S. House of Representatives. In speaking to a Muslim audience in New Jersey, said that Muslims should, quote, take over the United States and replace its constitutional government with a caliphate. If we united and strong, we'd elect our own emir, which is a leader, and give allegiance to him. Take my word. If 6 to 8 million Muslims unite in America, the country will come to us. This split personality is the cause of confusion because Americans in general, and unfortunately even many government leaders, are not digging into what these leaders say in Arabic. desperately wanting to believe the best of people in order to comfort themselves in times of great uncertainty. Most Westerners swallow much of the Islamic deception, hook, line, and sinker. Those few who are bold enough to speak the truth regarding the true nature of Islam are viewed and labeled as intolerant, hateful, bigoted, Islamophobic. One would think that Americans would be wise enough to wake up to this tired pattern by now. But apparently, ignorance truly is bliss. That is, until the front of the ship actually smashes, sort of like the Titanic, headlong into the iceberg.
Waleed Shubat, a former Muslim and, like Paul of the Bible, a former terrorist, now a watchman on the wall, is bringing the truth and warning on the issues of Islamic fundamentalism through television, radio, as well as the internet. Please help us by partnering with us today by calling 1-877-832-7200 or sending your tax-deductible donation to Forum for Middle East Understanding, 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940.
My name is Waleed Shuibat. I was born as a Muslim who desired the destruction of God's people. In trying to disprove the God of the Bible, I actually found him. Now I have dedicated my life to revealing the truth about Islam through books, radio, television, and the internet. In this series, we will discuss biblical end times prophecy and what the God of the Bible has to say about the very days we are living in now.
We meet at a time of great tension between the United States and Muslims around the world. The relationship between Islam and the West includes centuries of coexistence and cooperation, but also conflict and religious wars. I've come here to Cairo to seek a new beginning. The United States will never be at war with Islam.
Name me one that is not Muslim. In every single context where Christ is on earth fighting, he's fighting a Muslim country.
Does the Bible predict such a cataclysmic event with so many Muslim nations? The answer is absolutely yes.
So who exalts man above God, Christians or Muslims? Pride goes before the destruction and a haughty spirit before the fall, Proverbs 16:18. Christians are always accused by Muslims of exalting a man, Jesus, above God. Muslims take pride in the fact that their religion is the only one that correctly gives God honor and does not associate him with any mortal man as Christians do. But is this really true? Do Muslims exalt God above men and angels? Do Muslims honor Jesus as much as they claim? Do Muslims only treat God as perfect? Let's start with the most proud individual that exists, the devil himself. Satan desires to be like God and will spare no effort to achieve this end. I will be like the Most High, as in Isaiah 14 says. This declaration, more than any other, displays the level of arrogance and pride that defies the very essence of who Satan is. Throughout this series, I will repeat this point. What is the most holy in Islam is the most unholy in the Bible. And what is the most holy in the Bible is the greatest blasphemy in Islam. Muslims believe that the spirit that revealed the Quran to Muhammad was the angel Gabriel. The utter blasphemy of Islam can be seen is that Gabriel, in this case, is called by such titles as Amir al-Wahi, the princely spirit, Khazin al-Quds, the keeper of holiness, Ar-Ruh al-Amin, the trusted spirit, Ar-Ruh al-Qudus, the holy spirit. All these titles, from a biblical perspective, should belong to God and God alone. Yet, in Islam, they are given to this angel that appeared to Muhammad. As a Muslim, I had always argued that the idea of Jesus being God was utter blasphemy, since from the Muslim's viewpoint, Jesus was only a man. But I couldn't see the hypocrisy of my own beliefs. Islam teaches that the angel that Muhammad encountered is the Holy Spirit. Could anything be more transparently blasphemous? While Muslims accuse Christians of blasphemy for calling Christ God, Muhammad, whose name means the praised one, is often treated by Muslims with a level of respect that should only be reserved for God alone. Yet they cannot see it. Why else would he be given such a glorious title as the glorious one? In scripture, names of prophets always pertain to glorifying God. Never a man, but Muslims do exalt Muhammad beyond any other being, either in heaven or on earth. When something as petty as a cartoon of Muhammad is published, Muslims throughout the world protest with an indignation that is unparalleled. Buildings were torched, dozens of Christians all over the world were murdered, and the cartoonist and his family now live in exile and their life is threatened constantly. While Muslims adamantly deny that they exalt Muhammad to the place of God, whenever you read Muslim literature in English, you will always see the acronym PBUH, which stands for Peace Be Upon Him, following Muhammad's name everywhere. But this translation is misleading and inaccurate. In Arabic, the phrase translated PBUH is Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which means the prayers and salutations of Allah be upon him. Muhammad Sallallahu means Allah prayed. How could Allah pray upon Muhammad? Ibn Kathir, the classical Quranic commentator, corroborates this. In the Arabic language, the basic meaning of salla is supplication. In religious terminology, salla is used to refer to the acts of bowing and prostration. So why do Muslims leave out the fact that the word prayer is present in the phrase? Because the phrase that is repeated by millions of Muslims every day actually means that Allah himself bows before and pray to Muhammad. This same phrase is even found in the Quran. Allah and his angels pray upon the Prophet. O ye who believe, pray upon him and salute him with worthy salutations. Muhammad is the center of praise, both in heaven and on earth. The Quran says, He, Allah, has subjected to you, Muhammad, whatever is in heavens and whatever is in the earth. Yet despite these entirely blasphemous claims, it is the Muslims who endlessly accuse Christians of blasphemy. In the exaltation of Muhammad to the place that only Christ or God could occupy, we see the hypocrisy and Luciferian nature of Islam. While Lucifer desires to be like God, so also has Islam exalted created beings, both demons and false prophets alike, to the place to replace God. But why must Muhammad exalt himself as God? The answer is found in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. For that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he, as God, sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Islam has a catch-22. Satan must deny the deity of Jesus because he wants to replace him. How can Satan take over that position as Messiah and be worshipped and at the same time accept Jesus' deity? The best argument he could create is that Jesus is a mere man. How could a man become God? He must destroy the deity of Christ and establish himself instead. Yet at the same time, he wants to be worshipped as God. He could not claim that Muhammad was God if he is to deny Jesus' deity. Satan must direct this worship to himself. The Bible has warned us that Satan will attempt to exalt his man, the Antichrist, over Christ. Islam does exalt Muhammad above Christ and downgrades Christ. Likewise, The Mahdi is believed to have the spirit of Muhammad, and so he will have the same attributes and will also occupy the Temple Mount. All this is written in the Islamic annals. From the day of their birth until their death, Muslims will hear it proclaimed millions of times that Muhammad is the most perfect man that has ever existed. Not only did we believe that he is superior to Christ, but we also believed that he actually shares many attributes and names with God himself. The name Muhammad is not a mere name for a man, according to the Quran. Allah, whose name is Mahmud, or the Glorious, or the Praised One, named Muhammad after himself. This is quite the claim. This is a further exaltation than the name Yeshua, which in English means Jehovah is our Savior. Muhammad literally means the Praised One, the Most Praised. Muhammad wanted to be like Christ. The Bible teaches that only Jesus is positioned at the right hand of God, where he is the only one that intercedes for mankind. Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us, Romans 8:34. One will never find in the scriptures Ezekiel, Daniel, or Amos, or Habakkuk, or Jeremiah called the Praised One. From a biblical perspective, this is blasphemous. But speaking of Muhammad, Dr. Haddad, a Muslim scholar, writes, "It may be that thy Lord will raise thee a praised estate." Quran 17:79. A station which the Prophet said none but he would receive, and this is the station of intercession, that the right of the glorious throne. He can even intercede. He sits on the glorious throne of God. Do you see how Islamic theology usurps the unique position of Christ and applies it to Muhammad? Islam will do the same with the Mahdi, Muhammad's ultimate successor. Do you see how crafty Satan's plan is? Like Muhammad, the Mahdi will claim to be exalted above all creation and will literally sit in the temple of God in Jerusalem, declaring the same titles that belong to God alone. Islam has replaced the sinless one with a prophet of Satan. Think about this fact. Islam, the fastest growing religion in the world, is and has been from its inception the quintessence of the very Antichrist spirit that John the Apostle warned us of. And now its curse is upon us.
We will return to Walid Shubat in a moment.
The man sitting next to me can certainly tell us he was a terrorist.
A former PLO terrorist.
Former terrorist now living in the US.
Former Muslim terrorist.
And raised a Muslim.
Fighting for the justice of Israel.
We have to stand with Israel. Judea is the heart of the Jewish people.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
Walid Shubat.
One word caused me to believe in the truth of the Bible, and that's the word Israel.
The problem is a massive racist ideology that is growing throughout the Middle East and the Muslim world.
On this program, we are offering for your gift of $45, God's War on Terror, the best-selling book based on the series End Times Today. Included in this offer is a free copy of Walid's new book, For God or for Tyranny, co-authored by his son, which outlines why, without God in government, there is no freedom. Please call now at 1-877-832-7200 or send your gift to Forum for Middle East Understanding at 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940. This is the first TV series produced by the Walid Shubat Foundation. With the support of many friends, has enabled us to produce this landmark TV series, which brings clarity to the scriptures concerning the end times. Walid Shubat, for 17 years, ever since converting to Christianity, after his wife challenged him to show her all the corruptions in the Bible, when he was trying to convert her to Islam. Since 2003, Walid has been speaking out on television, radio, and the internet concerning the threat of Islam reaching millions with the truth. We will now return to Walid Shubat on End Times Today.
Desiring to imitate Christ as he ascends to heaven, This fallen star was the same one which, according to the Quran, transported Muhammad from Al-Haram Mosque in Mecca to Al-Aqsa Mosque, the furthest mosque in Jerusalem, in Mishkatul Masabih. Muhammad describes his ascent through the seven heavens into the icy presence of the many-veiled Allah. This journey has come to be known as Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, or the ascension to heaven, or Muhammad's night journey. According to this claim, Allah ordered Jibreel, Gabriel in this case, to go down with 70,000 angels to Muhammad and stand by his door. Allah, Muhammad's Lord, ordered these angels to summon Muhammad, accompany him to my presence, as Allah says. According to this tale, Muhammad was awakened in the night by an angel who sat Muhammad on a strange creature called Al-Buraq, or the lightning bolt. Every Buraq has a crown on his forehead, inscribed with it the words, "There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger." "Arise, my master, and prepare yourself," cried the Buraq. "Ride on the back of the Buraq, the heavenly creature that will carry you on your journey to the Lord of Power," as it stated, "through the land of the angels." He, Muhammad, went to the paradise of the Buraqs, and there he found 40 million Buraqs. This story has many similarities to the story of Lucifer, master of the universe, the bright fallen angel who is mentioned in the Bible. "For you have said in your heart, 'I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God.' You were in Eden, the garden of God. 'I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.'" So on and so forth throughout the Bible, as Lucifer claimed he have ascended into heaven. This story is not only regarding Lucifer the angel, as he is cast out of heaven, but Lucifer the Antichrist. He is also the Antichrist man. He claims to have ascended into heaven. "For you have said in your heart, 'I will be like God.'" But we must also understand that in the text it also says, "But you were a man and not a God." So this Lucifer is called a man. Quote, "Is this the man who made the earth tremble?" Isaiah 14:16. Isaiah 14 is about the prophecy of the five eyes, this Lucifer. But he is called a man. When was this Lucifer a man? And when did he claim to have ascended to heaven? This story is identical to Muhammad's alleged heavenly ascension. It will also be the claim of the Mahdi, since Islam makes him the same man as Muhammad. In Dua al-Nudba, the prayer of the weeping, the classic Muslim poem about Muhammad's night journey, we read, "And made your east and west come under his feet, and harness for him the Buraq, and did make him ascend towards your heavens." In the ultimate expression of pride, like Nimrod at the Tower of Babel, Muhammad claims to have succeeded in ascending to heaven. Likewise, the Mahdi, who has the spirit of Muhammad and with Lucifer dwelling in him, will also make the same claims. Within many ancient cults, from Egyptian to Mayan, one can often find the worship of a feathered bird. The Bible also describes devils as demons with such language: "Babylon the Great is fallen, and is become habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and cage of every unclean, hateful bird." Ta'us al-Malaika, the peacock of the angels, as Islam calls him, as it's described in the annals of Islam as well, is the name that Islamic tradition gives to Muhammad's heavenly transport that supposedly carried Muhammad into the seventh heaven and then ordered him to rule over all of mankind and the multitudes of the demons. God in the Bible addresses Satan with, "You had the seal of perfection, full of wisdom, perfect in beauty," Ezekiel 28:12. This description is identical to the angel Muhammad encountered and described in the Quran chapter of An-Najm, or the star, as, quote, one mighty in power, the one endued with wisdom, Quran 56, 5 and 6. Is this coincidence? Even the precious stones mentioned with regard to this angelic heavenly transport, Al-Buraq, seems to fit what is written in scripture regarding Satan, quote, his color was that of a peacock whose plumage was set with red rubies and corals, on which sat a white head of musk on a neck of amber. His ears and shoulders were of pure white pearls attached with golden chains, each chain decorated with glittering jewels. His saddle was made of silk, lined with silver and gold threads. His back was covered with green emerald, and his halter was pure peridot. Now, compare the description of Muhammad's strange spirit guide with the description of Satan in the Bible. I quote the Bible, every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the lapis, lazuli, the turquoise, and the emerald, and the gold. The workmanship of your setting and sockets was in you, Ezekiel 28:13. Many of Satan's descriptions almost match perfectly the descriptions of the Buraq, Muhammad's steed, that he rode into heaven when he ascended to heaven, but beyond the ascension into heaven. This being the Buraq is also described specifically as an angel of light. Eventually, Satan will be judged for the iniquities of your trading, as the Bible says in Ezekiel 28:18. What does Satan trade in? The answer to this is simple: false religion and cults. The Muslim Sufis identify the spirit that inspired the Quran as the angel Jibril and refer to him as an angelic peacock. God created the spirit in a form of a peacock, as Islam teaches. The root word of Buraq, Muhammad's spirit guide, is Barq, which means lightning bolt or glowing light. The Bible describes Lucifer as, quote, burning like a torch or a lamp. This is exactly what the Quran describes Allah as, a lamp. Allah in the Quran dedicates chapter An-Nur, the light, as the most significant description of Allah. Light of the heavens and brightly shining star or luminous are satanic titles. Lucifer literally means the luminous one. Satan desires to be bright shining star. Even the Mahdi is identified by the Prophet Muhammad as the peacock of all angels. And of the dwellers of the heavenly realm, he is dressed and adorned with the cloaks of light. This lightning bolt described by Muhammad is described by Jesus. I saw Satan fall like lightning from the heaven, Luke 10:18. The word Lucifer means bearer of light or luminous or the morning star. The Bible warns us regarding the manner in which Satan disguises himself, quote, as an angel of light, 2 Corinthians 11:14. John as well describes him, I saw a star fallen from heaven to the earth. To him was given the key to the bottomless pit, Revelation 9:1. This star is referred to as him, a person, and not an actual star or an asteroid. The Quran even calls Allah the Lord of Star of Sirius, Quran chapter of the star, 53:49. The same star is described in Revelation 8:10. Then the third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch or a lamp, and it fell on the third of the rivers and on the springs of the waters. This is likely allegoric of peoples and multitudes and nations and different tongues, which Satan spiritually destroys, Revelation 17:15. Out of all the sinful and evil behaviors the Bible condemns, pride tops them all. The Quran, on the other hand, considers Allah as Al-Mutakabbir, which literally means the most proud one. Describing how important pride is to Allah, he even cloaks himself with, quote, pride is my wear, supremacy is my dress, I will break anyone who vies with me, and for them I do not care. And also, quote, glory be to the one who rightfully deserves to be called the most proud. He is Allah. However, such attire is an abomination to God. I will punish the king of Assyria, God says, which is the Antichrist, for the willful pride of his heart and the haughty looks in his eyes. Isaiah 10:12. Just as Allah links himself with pride, God links pride as the main behavior of the imposter and the greatest adversary ever, Satan. The Bible says, Son of man, say to the ruler of Tyre, which is the Antichrist, this is what the Jehovah, the Sovereign, says. In the pride of your heart you say, I am. Muslims exulting in Allah's pride are evident from their declaration, Allahu Akbar, which means Allah is greater. It is usually yelled out loud in unison by jihadists as a gesture of triumph. They are also the first words recited by the muezzin as he cries out from the minarets of the mosques. It is the spark of every rally, Allahu Akbar, when one ignites the crowd shouting that word, Takbir. The crowd then must respond, Allahu Akbar, Allah is greater, Allah the most proud. Every Muslim glorifies Allah in this manner. Quote, majesty and glory belong to Allah alone. This is pride in God in the purest sense of the word. Another title for Allah is Maliki Rabbil Alameen, which means the Lord of the Worlds. That is, this world and the underworld. O Allah, the Lord of the seven heavens and whatever it shadows, Lord of the two worlds and whatever it is carrying, Lord of the wind and whatever wherever it goes, Lord of the devils and whoever is unguided. Allah seems to have already been described in the Bible as the God of this world who has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel. Now is the judgment of the world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Muhammad definitely connected to the Lord of the air and the God of demons. In the Quran, Allah is also described as the Lord of the dawn and the bringer of evil. Quote from the Quran, say, I seek refuge with Allah, the Lord of the dawn, from the mischief of the evil that he, Allah, has created, from the mischievous evil of darkness as it becomes intensely dark. Quran 11, 4, 1-3. Seeking refuge in Allah, the Lord of the dawn or morning star, from the evil entities he created is similar to what the shamans do to ward off evil. This same son of the dawn, who the Bible attributes to all evil, or havoc, and the destruction of the earth, in Isaiah it says, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn, you have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. Isaiah 14:12.
Thank you for watching End Times Today. For more information, please visit us at www.shubat.com. shoebat.com. Thank you.
Walid Shubat, a former Muslim and like Paul of the Bible, a former terrorist, now a watchman on the wall, is bringing the truth and warning on the issues of Islamic fundamentalism through television, radio, as well as the internet. Please help us by partnering with us today by calling 1-877-832-7200 or sending your tax-deductible donation to Forum for Middle East Understanding, 2865 South Eagle Road, number 310, Newtown, Pennsylvania, 18940.